I'd like to welcome you all. My name is Sue Kegerreis. I'm director for the Centre for Psychoanalytic Studies. And we are actually expecting this whole room to be completely filled up in terms of the people who had signed up. So it is just possible that other people have gone to the theatre and will be joining us later. So we may be having some late arrivals, as we do normally have this event in the theatre. Anyway, just before we get down to the enjoyable bit of the evening, can I just ask you all to check your phones or anything else that might make a noise? I've been in a school concert and, you know, regaled everybody at the crucial moment. So do take that little bit of time to be careful on that score. And I've done mine. Have you done yours? Okay. All right. Okay. As you can see, the lecture is being recorded. We think that, in fact, the question answer session won't be. But if there is anything that gets said or that you would rather not be recorded, it can always be turned off. So do bear that in mind. So welcome to you all. It's lovely to see you all. This is the Centre for Psychoanalytic Studies 2015 Freud Memorial Lecture. It's our biggest and most important public-facing event during the year, so it's a high point of our year every time it happens. It has a long and illustrious history from really very near the beginning of the centre's founding. And it's a way of us constantly revisiting, revising, renewing and refreshing our sense of Freud's legacy. How it's been understood and taken up and adapted to the modern world, so both the continuities we have with his thinking and the ways in which it has been changed subsequently. Our speakers every year come from a very wide range of specializations, which have been influenced by his ideas and have contributed to either our clinical work, our organizational life, or indeed our culture. The Freud Memorial Lectures have a history from the beginning of the centre, as I've said, and that is down to the generous support of the Freud family through the offices of the Mark Patterson Agency, which is also responsible for the Freud copyright. And we have a Freud archive here at the university from the same source, funded by the same source. Mark's not able to be here tonight. He does usually come. But I wanted to thank him anyway for their generous support. Many of you know the centre already, some of you very well. But for those who don't, I just want to spend a very few moments just telling you a little bit about us. We are a thriving community of experienced clinicians and academics, staff and students, with programmes that range from foundation degrees through BAs, MAs and PhDs and professional doctorates. Research in the centre ranges from the most theoretical, conceptual, historical, and philosophical to the most practical and service orientated. If you want to know more about what we do, you've probably seen all the literature out there, but also there's lots more information on our website. We're also at a very exciting moment in the centre's history right now, as we've just embarked on a major expansion, particularly centering around the introduction of our new undergraduate degrees, but also expanding and continuing with all the things that we've been doing already so well. For the first time, though, school leavers are going to be able to come to the centre to pursue their first degree with us, enabling CPS to introduce psychoanalytic, psychodynamic and Jungian thinking to the next generation at a much earlier stage of their development. And this is something that we're very, very excited about, very nervous about, but very keen to promote, because it is a big adventure for us, and we hope a very successful venture for the centre and for those students. Now, just before we move on to tonight's lecture, I'd like to thank our admin staff from the centre who've worked very hard to make this event successful. That's Alison Evans, Fiona Gillis, Deb Payne and Debbie Stewart, and the staff of the Wivenhoe House here for hosting the event. Now for tonight. It's a real privilege to be able to introduce you to this year's distinguished speaker, Alessandra Lemma. Alessandra is the director of the Psychological Therapies Development Unit at the Tavistock and Portman NHS Foundation Trust and consultant adult psychotherapist at the Portman Clinic, where she specializes in work with transsexuals. She's a fellow of the British Psychoanalytical Society and visiting professor at the Psychoanalysis Unit, University College London, and honorary professor of psychological therapies in the school here at HHS. She's the clinical director of the Psychological Interventions Research Centre at UCL. She has a strong interest in psychological therapies and is a supervisor and trainer in interpersonal psychotherapy, IPT. She's been a leading member of the team developing the new protocol for brief psychodynamic interventions for mood disorders, DIT, dynamic interpersonal therapy. I had to cut her biography a lot. This is a really edited version, some of the highlights, because there's so much, and it's really very impressive and humbling to read all the things she's been doing. She's held prominent editorial roles in a range of major journals in the profession and has published and spoken very widely. So I think we're very glad and privileged to have her here to talk to us tonight on the topic of minding the body, the body in psychoanalysis and beyond.
Thank you very much indeed for this very generous introduction and for giving me the opportunity to be with you tonight. It's a real honour. What I'm going to speak to you about tonight really arises from the interest I've had throughout all of my career, but certainly over the last 10 years or so, in working with individuals who use the body primarily as the medium to communicate what it is that they feel troubled about. And in particular, in the last few years, I've focused on working with people who extensively modify their bodies through a range of interventions, including cosmetic surgery, tattooing, piercings, scarifications, and obviously sex reassignment surgery more latterly. But I thought that perhaps the best way to introduce some of the ideas that have been helpful to me in making sense of these experiences was to kind of structure the talk by sharing some of the core assumptions that underpin my work as a way of sort of sharing with you ideas, both conceptual as well as much more kind of technical considerations, which hopefully will stimulate a useful discussion between ourselves later on. I think it's fair to say that the body always speaks. The task of the analyst is to listen to what it expresses or what it conceals in its relative noisiness or quietness. In some cases, it is the patient's body that is very loud and is the presenting complaint. It is sometimes a hated body or a body felt to be in some kind of physical pain. In others, the body is quiet, neglected, or denied in the patient's experience. And yet it is very powerfully present in the therapeutic relationship, echoing in the analyst in their somatic countertransference, where its as yet unarticulated story is received and gradually put into words. How we listen to the body and its narrative is of course filtered through the analyst's own subjectivity, which comprises both bodily and psychic components, and the analyst's guiding theoretical and technical principles or assumptions. As analysts, we all implicitly and or explicitly orientate ourselves in our encounters with patients according to theories and assumptions that ideally function as flexible guides in our work, allowing us to meet the needs of a given patient at a given point. Now, the first assumption that informs my work is that embodiment shapes the mind. As such, it is essential for the analyst to always keep the body in mind, even when the patient is not bringing the body explicitly as the problem they want help with. Mind and body are inseparable. The mind is indeed inconceivable without some sort of embodiment, a notion that is now espoused by many. Now, the body is a basic fact of life that supports all other psychic functions. Hence, when it's denied, emotional, social, and cognitive functioning can be severely impaired. Escaping the reality of the body invariably entails an escape from a place in the mind where thinking and feeling are possible, and hence where relating to the other as other is also possible. This is readily apparent in those individuals, for example, who defensively retreat into virtual reality as a means of bypassing the psychic implications of being in a body, a need that may be particularly acute during adolescence when the body presents itself forcefully to the mind. Now, the mind-body conundrum has taxed some of the greatest minds in science, philosophy, and psychoanalysis. And it really isn't the aim of tonight's talk to provide a comprehensive overview of the various arguments that have been put forward. Rather, I'm going to restrict myself here to some key psychoanalytic contributions that have been very helpful to me in my work as a clinician, and also contributions from fields that I believe to be very relevant to the development of psychoanalysis, most notably the field of neuroscience. But before you get anxious, this is not a talk explicitly about neuroscience, but I will bring that in a little bit, she says very apologetically. Now, one of the key notions that informs my work, above all else, roots us firmly in Freudian territory. Namely, as Freud famously put it, that the ego is, and to quote him, first and foremost, a body ego. It is not merely a surface entity, but it is itself the projection of a surface. End of quote. That is, the most primitive form of self-representation is a body representation. For Freud, the ego was thus represented as a psychical map, a projection of the surface of the body. More specifically, the ego was seen to be a mental representation of the individual's perceived libidinized relationship to his body. One important implication of this, which has been richly elaborated since Freud, is that the ego derives its functioning from body models. This is perhaps most evident in the writings of Melanie Klein, where the mind itself is described as a kind of alimentary tract, to use Robert Capa's turn of phrase, taking in, that is introjecting, and expelling, that is projecting, psychic states of mind. In a similar vein, Fennekel in the 1940s emphasized that the baby's first reality is what can be swallowed. The acts of taking into the mouth and spitting out formed, according to him, the foundation of all experience. Freud, and later Paul Schilder in his landmark study of the body image, proposed that proprioception has a decisive place in the development of a body-related sense of self. They both essentially underline how, at the beginning of life, internal perceptions are more fundamental than external ones in shaping the ego. In other words, throughout life, ego structure and identity are founded to a significant degree on the sensations and awareness of the body. Freud thus cemented the view, later developed by others, that the body self is the container and foundation for the sense of self. For Freud, the drives always had their source in the most inner part of the body. He defined the drive, and I quote him, as the psychical representative of the stimuli originating from within the organism and reaching the mind. He adds that the drive, and again I quote him, is a measure of the demand made upon the mind for work in consequence of its connection with the body. If we think of his definition of the drive, it is this reference to work that explains the transformations that take place, changing the contents of its initial expression. Now, Freud's emphasis on the body is well placed and ties in with current neuroscientific perspectives, and indeed, we could say, anticipates them. Physical movement and the registration of that movement in a developing proprioceptive system, that is a system that registers its own self-movement, contributes to the self-organizing development of neuronal structures, responsible not only for motor action, but also for the way we become conscious of ourselves, for how we communicate with others, in short, for how we live. Physical movement, and of course how others respond to that movement, prefigures the lines of intentionality. Gesture shapes the contours of social cognition. And it is in this most general and most fundamental sense that embodiment shapes the mind. Drawing on psychoanalysis, Merleau-Ponty in the 1960s suggested that the body, and I quote him, operates according to a latent knowledge it has of the world, a knowledge anterior to cognitive experience. To have a body, he adds, is to possess a universal setting, a schema of all types of perceptual unfolding. Merleau-Ponty's model of embodied intentionality includes a space for the body schema. Now, the body schema needs to be differentiated from the notion of the body image. It refers to the system of sensory motor processes that constantly regulate posture and movement, and is, if you like, a set of laws rather than images. Now, as clinicians, we tend to be more concerned with the body image, that is, the representation we have of our body in our mind, with the attendant affect and fantasies associated with it. We are, therefore, mostly concerned with the psychic libidinal map of the body, which is organized not just by the laws of biology, but also by the meanings and fantasies we bring to our experience of the body. It is, in fact, more apt to say that we're always dealing with an imaginary anatomy. Whereas the body schema is constitutionally based, the body image therefore rejoins us to the importance of an intersubjective context in which the given body develops. The body image is not innate, and here psychoanalysis can make a valuable contribution in understanding the developmental factors and the fantasies, conscious and unconscious, that play a part in shaping and effectively colouring the representation of the body in our minds. In my work, I approach the perception the patient has of his body as reflecting certain dispositions that he has towards it, that is, the patient's beliefs and fantasies, as well as certain dispositions that his body has towards the world, that is, a particular posture, a sense of balance, and other visceral autonomic aspects of embodiment. The body schema, we might therefore say, constrains intentionality, but it is object relationships that lend to it its affective resonance as reflected in the patient's body image. In order to underline what I consider to be the essential dynamically unconscious dimension of the representation we have of our bodies at any point in time, I prefer to use the term body imaginings. This term, I think, more accurately denotes the potential fluidity in our body image, whilst also underscoring that the representation of the body in the mind is an unconscious psychic organization powered by particular fantasies of the self and of the other, which can, in the context of a psychotherapy or psychoanalysis, be elaborated in the transference relationship. Body imaginings grow out of the earliest internal bodily experiences, for example, of pain or pleasure, in relation to others, and colour the individual's experience of his body self. The body imagining is therefore the image we have of our bodies in our minds, as Paul Schildert had noted, resulting from the idiosyncratic meanings which the body has been endowed with through these earliest exchanges. It is built on projective and introjective mechanisms. And importantly, the body representation is fundamentally a function of libidinal cathexes. Now, the way we experience our body is shaped by the meanings and fantasies of others. Hence, our body recounts the story of several generations. Our body representation results from the internalization of the others, and principally in early development, the mothers, body imaginings through the unconscious transmission of gestures, posture, mannerisms, rhythms, all of which contain affectively laden representations of the self in interaction with the other. Just like her baby, the mother therefore will have also internalized an experience of her body with another. The mother's experience of her own body will influence how she relates to the baby's physicality. Infants who are classified as anxiously attached frequently have mothers who demonstrate an aversion to close body contact. The baby's experience of his own body is thus mediated by what he experiences as the mother's or the other's relationship to his body. And what she feels about his body will be mediated by what she feels about her own body. When the mother or father or significant other have experienced difficulties in this respect, the baby's body may become the receptacle for their own projections. unresolved trauma may indeed manifest in body modification by proxy, as it were, leading to intrusion into the other's body. And it's been an aspect that I found very interesting in my experience of working with young people who have undergone rather early on in their development cosmetic surgery at the instigation of one or both parents. And actually, when you delve into the family dynamics, it becomes very clear that it is the parents who have a lot of unresolved issues relating to their own experience of their bodies and often their sexuality. But this is projected into the young person who is supported to have a nose job or other kinds of cosmetic surgery, which are totally not needed. So given all of the above considerations, we can see why reductionistic neurological accounts of the body can never capture adequately the schematic operations in which the body acquires a specific organization or style in its relationship with others, that is, within a particular emotional and, of course, also a particular social context. And yet, by rejoining psychoanalysis with neuroscientific perspectives, we are helpfully reminded of the importance of both the body schema that leads to habitual dispositions and how this always develops in a dynamic relationship to emotional environments. A focus on the body, of course, raises important questions about pre-symbolic experience and how this itself is encoded, and, of course, how it is then communicated to others. While we communicate through our culture's grammar and lexicon, the derivatives of gestural language which express themselves as the prosodic elements of speech, such as rhythm or tonality, are like a primordial grammar, as Fonagy and Targi have put it, that provides a secondary channel for communication, conveying what is non-conscious, and that might only subsequently become dynamically excluded from consciousness for defensive purposes. Considerations about gestural language and what is implicitly communicated through the body rejoins us again with other disciplines that are relevant to approaching the body both conceptually and clinically. Neuroscientific research in particular has clarified how the infant is equipped with a body schema and with a proprioception, intermodal transducers and mirror neurons genetically coded for the expressive intersubjective movement that is human interaction. Crucially, the body image originates in the intermodal and intersubjective interaction between proprioception and the vision of the other's face. The intentions of the other person and the embodied possibilities of the interacting infant can be directly read in the face and physical actions of the other. This provides another angle on the importance of the quality of the embodied experience of the caregiver and, we might add, therefore, between patient and therapist too. During such nonverbal exchanges in which both parents and infants express their minds and respond to the other's mind mainly without awareness and often through the body, the parent's ability to make sense of the infant's nonverbally expressed internal world is key to the laying of the foundations for developing the capacity to mentalize experience. Indeed, it's been proposed that what is now being called parental embodied mentalizing, which can now also be measured, is a key feature of the development of mentalizing. Parental embodied mentalizing refers to the parental capacity to implicitly and not necessarily consciously conceive, comprehend, and extrapolate the infant's mental states, that is, the infant's wishes, desires, preferences, from the infant's whole body kinesthetic expressions, namely changes in body movement and posture, and adjust their own kinesthetic patterns accordingly. The notion of embodied mentalizing provides, I think, a very helpful perspective in relation to the tensions that can be discerned in the literature between one and two-person psychoanalytic models with respect to the body, because it reconciles the fact of the body and its individuality and predispositions, what we might call its constitutional endowment, along with how the experience of being in a body requires the body and mind of another to encourage the capacity to mentalize one's bodily experience and hence to regulate affective experience. Now, the second assumption that informs my work and that flows from the notion of an embodied self concerns the clinical implications of Freud's theoretical insights about the importance of the body-ego. This was very well captured by the analyst Henry Ray, who reminds us that, and I quote him, "In every analysis, one has to arrive at the body-self if one wants to achieve deep and enduring change." Indeed, I think understanding the patient's experience of the body-self is fundamental to understanding psychic structure. This is important with all patients, but it is even more prescient with patients whose psychopathology is expressed through the body. As analysts and therapists, we always work on the frontier of the soma and of the psyche. Because our experience of the world is inevitably mediated from the unique perspective of our body, to understand the relationship between body and mind, we have to think on the boundary of the real and of the imagined body, on the boundary of one body and of two or more bodies. Indeed, the analyst's body acts as a powerful catalyst for the patient's associations and fantasies, not least when the body of the analyst is somehow altered, for example, through illness, or in more mundane ways, such as through surface changes in appearance, a haircut, or indeed, of course, the analyst being pregnant. Elsewhere, I have given consideration to the analyst's body and whether it may be useful, in fact, to conceptualize it as a feature of the analytic setting. The body behind the couch that is visible to the patient at the start and end of sessions, or the body in the chair that sits opposite the patient, needs to be considered alongside the consciously and unconsciously fantasized body of the analyst, outside as well as inside the actual consulting room itself. Those patients who have difficulty in establishing and maintaining a stable differentiation from the other typically present with marked difficulties in symbolization and may powerfully project into the analyst's body, as analysts working with psychotic patients and autistic children often also note. The analyst's consequent somatic countertransferential reactions may be understood to result from projective processes that bypass verbal articulation and that are deposited in the body. By somatic countertransference, I have in mind a plethora of sensory and motoric experiences, such as the analyst feeling discomfort in the body, alterations in breathing, feeling tired, sleepy or restless, feeling itchy or nauseous, and so on. Again, in order to understand the underlying mechanisms of somatic countertransference, I have found it helpful to turn to neuroscientific research. Nowadays, the motor system is no longer relegated to a merely executive role. Rather, it is thought to be far more complex, formed by a mosaic of frontal and parietal brain areas that are closely interconnected with the visual, auditory, and tactile areas. One implication of this is that perception appears to be directly immersed in the dynamics of action. Mirror neurons exemplify this as they show how recognition of other people's actions, and even of their intentions, depends in the first instance on our motor resources. To put it simply, the discovery of mirror neurons reveals that thought originates in the body in movement. Vittorio Gallese, who was one of the two people to discover mirror neurons, has suggested that the mirroring mechanism for action and other mirroring mechanisms in our brain represent instantiations of embodied simulation. Embodied simulation provides a new empirically based notion of intersubjectivity, viewed first and foremost as what he refers to as intercorporeity. Internal, non-linguistic representations of the body states associated with actions, emotions, and sensations are evoked in the observer as if he or she were performing a similar action or experiencing a similar emotion or sensation to the person that is being observed. Now, I think that the work of Vittorio Gallese and colleagues is especially pertinent to our understanding of the somatic countertransference. Gallese proposes, and I quote him now, social cognition is not only social metacognition, that is, explicitly thinking about the contents of someone else's mind by means of abstract representations. There is also an experiential dimension of interpersonal relationships, which enables a direct grasping of the sense of the actions performed by others and of the emotions and sensations that they experience. This dimension of social cognition is embodied in that it mediates between the multimodal experiential knowledge we hold of our lived body and the experience we make of others. End of quote. So, by means of an isomorphic format, we can map others' actions onto our own mortal representations, as well as others' emotions and sensations onto our own visceromotor and somatosensory representations. Our brains and those of other primates, Galese suggests, appear to have developed embodied simulation as a basic functional mechanism that gives us a direct insight into other minds, thus enabling our capacity to empathize with others, and we might add the capacity to mentalize. Now, what's going to be quite interesting in the generations to come is to see what happens to this as we live in increasing context where much of our communication is mediated via technology. So I think this is quite an interesting challenge to think about, but I think it is too early to know. Now, if we return to the analytic situation, we recognize as analysts that the patient's bodily states of mind inevitably impact on and are in turn impacted on by our bodily states of mind. That is, the patient communicates through his body and the therapist analyst receives such communications in her body. Of course, this cannot be considered to be an identical reflection of what the patient experiences, because in the process of being received by the analyst, what is projected is also modified by the analyst's own internal world. Indeed, nowadays, the inevitability of the analyst's own subjectivity is recognized by analysts across many different schools, even if I think it's fair to say that the technical implications of this fact are approached very differently across different schools. But this subjectivity involves a bodily dimension and is expressed through the analyst's physical presence and the accompanying emotional atmosphere that the analyst's physicality contributes to. It is therefore incumbent on us as clinicians to be connected to what being in a body means to us. Our embodied nature poses challenges to us all, as well as providing a vital register of what transpires between patient and analyst. Analytic work requires, therefore, that we keep in mind not just the patient's body, but also our own, so as to monitor what we might call our own body-based blind spots. When we consider pre-symbolic forms of communication that bypass verbal articulation, we are immediately alerted to the fact that in the clinical situation, the scope for enactment is always wide, because we are here in the realm of pre-symbolic functioning in the patient and potentially also in the analyst, whose capacity for symbolic elaboration of their own bodily experience may be temporarily disrupted. Such bodily experiences need to become thoughts with a thinker, to play on Bion's turn of phrase, and eventually shared with the patient in order to support the development of a capacity to symbolize. My third assumption is that seeing and being seen are central dynamics in early life that shape the development of the self, and specifically of the self's experience of embodiment. These dynamics are played out in the analytic relationship such that we always need to consider the reciprocal observation in the consulting room, that is, the way in which both analyst and patient function as visual objects for the other. Now, in normal development, we recognize that in order for us to see ourselves, we must be seen. From the moment of birth, we see our own possibilities in the faces of others. What we don't see shapes our internal experience as much as what we do see. The self as visual object for the other is a challenge we are thus all faced with. Sartre captured very well the interpersonal tension that we all have to manage in his discussion of what he called the look. He described two different kinds of looking. There is the me who looks, what he called the voyeur, but this me who looks gives way to the me who is on view, the spectacle. The tables turn round, always. The realization that the world assumes its coherence in relation to the other's perspective is deeply threatening, not least because this other perspective is inaccessible to us insofar as we cannot control in any absolute way the other person's thoughts, feelings, or perceptions. Being cognizant of our own specularity leads to the discovery that our foundations lie outside of oneself, or, as Sartre put it, that we exist for the other. This existing for the other implies a state of dependency that is experienced first and foremost in the body. Lacan's field of vision adds to this by introducing the central role of desire, which I won't have time to go into. And he, of course, proposes that the other's gaze, through which the voyeur becomes a spectacle for the other, strips him of his sense of illusory mastery. Indeed, no matter how we present ourselves, we cannot ultimately control what the other sees. This is so because the other's perception of us is embedded in a shifting matrix of their own unconscious feelings, memories, and fantasies, and it is filtered through projective mechanisms that either make us libidinally resonant, bad, or invisible to the other. I think what's crucial about what both Sartre and Lacan have to say about looking, albeit that they approach this from very different conceptual frameworks, is that one's body for the other is also always a potential site for alienation. My fourth and final assumption is that in order to understand the patient's experience of the body self, we need to understand the primordial relationship we all have with the maternal body. This relationship may be one primarily characterized by envy or by a dread of falling back into the mother's body. Being trapped inside the maternal body may be dreaded because it is engulfing, but it may also be sought after through violent projective identification, because inside, the individual is spared the narcissistic injury associated with being outside and hence separate. Our sense of who we are is founded, we might say, on the loss of the mother. A fundamental component of who I am is inevitably a person whose mother is gone, since at birth the self is exposed to its first loss, the loss of residence inside the mother's body. The fact of separateness and loss is, as we know, an important dimension of subjectivity, and it is intimately linked to the experience of envy. When dependency and loss cannot be borne, envy can come to dominate the psychic landscape. In some of the individuals I've worked with who turn to the modification of the body for a solution to psychic pain, we can observe how this modification serves the function of bypassing the experience of being given to, of being dependent in any way on the other. Separation from the maternal body always entails a degree of trauma, and hence how the separation is experienced leaves emotional residues in us all. Analytic work with patients who modify their bodies extensively has helped me to appreciate that the patient's deficits and conflicts often relate to the vicissitudes of separation from the mother's body that may manifest in a variety of ways, for example, as dermatological conditions or somatization disorders, or in the patient's relationship, for example, to something like the analyst's hair or to their own hair. Indeed, a recurrent theme throughout my work with individuals who modify their bodies is the apparent deficits in relation to the development of a solid sense of their body as a boundary to physical space and the painful difficulty they experience of living in their own skin. Instead, they sometimes seek to recreate a state of fusion with the maternal body that is then subjected to perverse and/or violent assaults in their own mind. I've come to understand that the more compulsive and extreme forms of body modification reflect a difficulty in integrating this most basic fact of life. We cannot give birth to ourselves. This truth is felt nowhere more acutely than in our bodies. The body is testament to our interrelatedness. The shared corporeality of the mother and baby from which we all have to emerge is the embodied version of psychic dependency. The emergence out of this shared physical space is never absolute, however, because the body is indelibly inscribed with the imprint of the mother. When the fact of our dependency on others cannot be integrated into our sense of who we are, the subjective experience of the body is typically compromised. Now, one way to manage the painful gap between self and other is through identification, a process that has been invariably disturbed in the patients I have in mind. The vicissitudes of identification are such that the fate of the idealized other can be uncertain depending on the self's capacity to grant the other its separateness and autonomy. A healthy identification, we might say, is inspired by the perceived ideal form of the other, but it is not equated with it. Rather, it involves forming an imaginary alignment in our minds, acknowledging its source, and then making it our own. Those who yearn to be the ideal, as one can observe in patients who pursue in rather compulsive ways cosmetic surgery, for example, these individuals, I think, apprehend the futility of their efforts through the dystopia of the fragmented body, not infrequent, for example, in the dreams of body dysmorphic patients, attesting to their struggle to integrate the body into their image of themselves. Dream images of distorted, attacked, cut-up bodies lay bare the envy that is felt towards those whose imagined bodily integrity and beauty is but a sore reminder of their felt insufficiency. Analysis reveals how these attacks are unconsciously aimed at a bountiful but unyielding maternal body that is perceived, and what it stands for in the unconscious. For these patients, the other is perceived to possess the wholeness or unity of which the self feels deprived. This has been a striking feature in my work with several women who underwent cosmetic surgery and who, through the surgery, appropriated something they felt was better, for example, the bigger breasts, that did not belong to the self, and that the internal mother was felt to possess and to withhold, as I will now illustrate through my work with Miss A, who over time increased to a 4 times weekly analysis over a 4-year period. Miss A, an only child, was born prematurely. Due to birth complications, her mother had been seriously at risk when she gave birth to her. She recalled growing up in the shadow of these very traumatic early events. She knew from her father that her mother had become very depressed following her birth, and she had taken time out, which was a term the family used, leaving Miss A for many months in the care of her father, who was himself often away on business, and so she spent most of her time with rather elderly paternal grandparents. She had therefore spent the best part of the first year of her life without a mother able to be responsive to her needs or, importantly, to take any pleasure in her. She made a point early on of telling me, rather reproachfully, that her mother had been unable to breastfeed her. Miss A was clear that she had never felt close to her mother and that her mother had never taken much of an interest in her. Although her father was described as more sympathetic, he was felt to have been largely absent. As an adolescent, Miss A had become very preoccupied with what she perceived to be her small breasts. She felt deeply unattractive, and she told me that she could barely think about anything else, counting the days till she could have surgery to enlarge her breasts. She hated swimming and the summer months because this exposed what she called her disadvantage. She vividly conveyed the way in which, in her mind, the world was full of people with large, plentiful breasts who had access to men and all good things in life that were instead denied to her. Age 22, not long after she had left university and secured her first job, she underwent surgery to augment her breasts. She recalled this being the best time in her life. She felt confident, she had her first sexual relationship, and she appeared to have been at least less consciously burdened by her entrenched grievance towards her mother. Now, I met Miss A when she was in her early 30s and she had just become a mother herself. It was this transition to motherhood that provoked a pronounced depressive breakdown. She had to be admitted very briefly. She found it hard to adjust to her baby's dependency on her, and she didn't breastfeed her daughter, who was said to have feeding difficulties. Her husband was described as very similar to her father, a reliable man whom she felt, however, wasn't very attuned to the difficulties that she was experiencing. Nevertheless, he had supported her coming into treatment, and I sense that she found it very difficult to even credit him with this. From the outset, even though she attended regularly, I was confronted by her difficulty in receiving any help from me, as if the only tenable psychic position was to feel she could give herself all that she needed. Alongside what I came to regard as being a rather omnipotent stance, I also felt very closely scrutinized by her. More specifically, as she arrived and left the sessions, I felt that she very closely surveyed my body. At times, she explicitly made reference to what I wore, for example, speculating about the designers I liked, which she would then rubbish with statements like, "Well, they're a bit passé, but fashion recycles itself, I guess." Several weeks after this statement, Missé arrived wearing a very similar dress to mine, only the colour was different, but made no reference to this. Her interest in my bodily self felt very controlling and intrusive. I'm going to now share a brief excerpt from a session that occurred towards the end of the first year of our work. In the preceding session to the one I shall report, she had become very preoccupied with a friend's decision to have breast augmentation surgery. Depicting this friend as in, as she put it, desperate need of the surgery because she was in such torment about her own small breasts. Missé said that her own breast augmentation had been a positive step, even though she was sure that I didn't see it that way. In the same session, Missé had alluded to difficulties with her husband. She swayed between casually playing with the idea that she could leave him and the thought that he might leave her. In this session, I had felt that she was the one in desperate need, given how difficult things had actually become in her marriage, and yet she wasn't connected to this in any real way. So the patient begins like this. "My friend has finally set a date for the surgery. I will accompany her. I keep telling her that there is nothing to worry about, that she will be fine and will feel better once it's over. I had a weird dream last night that I found you, that is me, walking in the street and you were wounded. I don't know why, but I woke up this morning thinking that you've been looking very tired lately. You look like you've shrunk, and that maybe something's up in your life." Now, I should say her perception of me was very interesting because I'd just come back from a holiday in the sun. So in fact, if anything, I was looking healthier than I had been beforehand. So it was, the contrast was very striking. So I just said, "What's on your mind in relation to that?" The patient said, "I saw a removal van outside in your street a few days ago. A man was loading a lot of things in it, antiques. I've seen him before. I think it's your husband. So I thought that this might be him moving out. I was thinking that if my husband and I ever split up, it will be painful to divide our possessions. There are some things that I feel are mine, and I would be determined to fight for them. Well, I guess that if it was your husband, you won't want to talk about it with me. Anyway, I know that therapists have their own therapy, lots of supervision, lots of money," and she laughs at this point, "so you're probably all right." And her tone felt very dismissive. So I said, "In your dream, you see me wounded, shrunken, with nothing left. And yet there is another me who has it all, support, money, holidays." And there was a silence. Then she said, "My friend will feel better. I've told her that the pain and discomfort she will feel post-op is nothing," and she said this really emphatically, "nothing compared to how much better she will feel eventually. Anyway, she can take pain relief. These days, if you get the right anaesthetist and the right pain control, you don't have to feel any pain." And then she goes into a lot of detail about the operation, the breast augmentation she underwent, and I feel it's all become very removed from the difficult reality of our exchange, as if she's now in a place in her mind where she's completely in control and can give herself the breast that she needs. I eventually said, "It's very hard to think with me about how you are actually feeling. Instead, you retreat into a nothing part of your mind where you don't have to feel anything and you can provide for yourself." And as she resumes speaking, she sounds very irritated with me. "I feel fine, okay, in as much as things are okay these days. As I said the other day, my husband is becoming impossible. He needs so much from me that I simply can't give him. But I'm fine. It will all come out in the wash. But sometimes it just feels like he demands too much of me. Everyone wants a piece of me right now, and I just want to say to them, keep out." I said, "That's what you're saying to me right now. Leave me alone. You're asking too much of me." and this was followed by a very long silence. She eventually broke by saying, "My daughter is still fussing over food. She must be hungry, but she seems determined not to eat. She refuses to eat. That's how it feels, purposeful. I will need to take her to the doctor again." And she goes into long detail about various consultations with doctors that she invariably concludes can't help her. And although this again has a distancing effect on me, I am struck that I remain very connected with one aspect of what she said, and that I'm very moved by the picture of the hungry daughter who refuses to eat. And so I say to her, "You are also hungry and need help, but you come here determined to prove that what I have to offer will be useless to you. It's as if you have to deny what you need from me and refuse what I offer so as to hold yourself together." And after a long silence, she starts to cry. She says, "My husband told me last night that he couldn't stand it any longer. He's thinking that he should move out for a while." Now, I won't go further into this session, but I'll move to a session 2 weeks later when she arrived for the first session of the week in a state of heightened anxiety. Her friend had now had the breast augmentation surgery and had suffered rather horrible complications. She was now in a lot of pain. Miss Say told me that she felt really badly about this because she'd been so sure that it would all be fine. It had all been fine for her. She spoke very rapidly, and it was clear that beyond the concern that she felt about her friend's well-being, more was psychically at play here. I said that she was evidently feeling very responsible and guilty, as if she had damaged her friend. She paused and then said that she did feel very badly about it all. She had been barely sleeping since it all happened. She then recounted a nightmare she'd had the previous night when she had taken a sleeping tablet and had managed to sleep for a few hours. In the dream, she is asleep and some aliens come through the window that she left open by accident. The aliens look very odd. They are all very small women, like dwarfs, and they gather around her bed. She feels terrified as they get out small carving knives and start to make incisions all over her body. And she shouts, "What do you want from me?" But no one replies. They then cut into her breasts and dig out the implant, and she feels the most acute pain. Miss A said that this had been a terrible dream. She'd struggled to shake it off, but it had got under my skin, she added. I said that in the dream itself, the small aliens had got under her skin, exposing her own breast surgery and removing her implants. She said the dream must be connected to the friend's surgery, but she was really struck by how nasty the small aliens were. I said it was interesting that they were all women. She said yes, but they were strange-looking women because they had no breasts. I remained quiet as I hoped that she might elaborate on this interesting detail, but in fact she went quiet. And I eventually said that something appeared to have made her go quiet. She said she had no idea why. She had just suddenly run out of thoughts about the dream. I said it was curious that she dried up just as she had revealed what seemed to be an important feature of the women aliens. They had no breasts and instead were violently ripping hers out in the dream. And she folded her arms as I spoke as if to protect her breasts, and she looked very uneasy as she lay on the couch. I said that she seemed to be feeling quite anxious again. She said that it was a horrible image. She wondered if her friend might wish she had never undergone the surgery, given how it had all gone wrong. I said that her dream perhaps connected her to a part of her mind that recognized that even if the operation had been successful in her own case, in a physical sense, the dream exposed her to another more horrible, violent perspective on the surgery and what it represented. She felt that she had stolen the breasts and they were now being repossessed. She was silent for a long time. She then said that one of the alien women in the dream reminded her of a dwarf woman she'd seen in the street some months previously. She had found it impossible not to stare at this woman, even though her mother had always told her not to stare at people less fortunate than herself. I said that today she was very afraid that I was looking down on her shrunken self, and she was the one without breasts. She nodded, saying she thought I was lucky, though, that I had what I needed. Now, I will leave the material there, but say a few words about it, because where there has been an undercathexis of the bodily self by the mother, as I think was the case for Miss A, envy of the fantasized maternal body may be discerned. Whatever the cause of the mother's lack of desire, The self may experience this as a refusal to give what is needed in order to feel desirable. Instead, the maternal object is felt to indulge in the withheld desirable goods. Deprived of sufficient gratification, the self then feels hard done by and may hold a grudge against the felt-to-be-depriving other. For Miss A, I'm suggesting that her grievance took the very concrete form of trying to acquire for herself the maternal breast through breast augmentation. The felt-to-be flawed birth by the biological mother is corrected omnipotently by the operative birth. But in my experience of these cases, the so-called surgical father is but a small bit player, never credited with his separateness either. In other words, in the kinds of fantasies that underpin some pursuals of cosmetic surgery, the parental couple is killed off, not just the mother. Now, of course, it's important to state that the decision to pursue cosmetic surgery and procedures is by no means always an indicator of pathology. Rather, what requires understanding when such surgery is requested is the state of mind of the patient in relation to the surgery and the unconscious meaning that this holds for her or him. Throughout life, the body is the arena of a potentially terrifying lack of control. The body is disturbing, as I've been suggesting, because it always bears the trace of the other. This fundamental psychic truth must somehow be integrated into our image of ourselves. The body ideally provides an anchor in reality, not least the reality of the parental couple who gives us birth, and hence acts as a reminder imprinted on the given body of the reality of difference and insufficiency that have to be borne rather than omnipotently denied. Being in a body, therefore, entails acknowledgement of the time of the couple, that is, a time before the body and hence before the self was given life. The body, in this sense, is integral to the establishment of the temporal link that provides a sense of continuity in our experience of who we are over time and links us to others on whom we have dependent and may continue to depend on. Extensive modification of the body, for example, such as that undertaken by transsexual individuals, can impair their orientation in time as a new modified body, and hence the self, is unanchored in a given body that provides a crucial link between past and present. Now, the disruption of the temporal link is strikingly apparent in the cases of some adolescent transsexuals, where the suspension of puberty through medication, hormones, can lead to a highly disruptive psychic and physical hibernation. And there is now an increasing pressure to perform these operations at ever younger ages, which I think has rather important implications for psychological adjustment. Because what has to be kept in mind, I think what the work with such individuals, not just transsexuals, but generally people who extensively modify their bodies, points out is that the patient struggles to remember that physically edited bodies are always bodies with a history. The given bodily configuration and appearance, even when at odds with subjective experience and the wished for body image, informs the representation of the body in the mind and needs to be integrated into the self-experience, even if the body is then subsequently modified. For the patients I've worked with, this typically involves painstaking work in order to help them to personalize the body, as Winnicott would put it. So, just a couple of concluding thoughts. Of course, the individual body doesn't exist in a vacuum. It develops and reacts to external forces as much as it does to internal ones. So to conclude, I want to share all too briefly one final personal thought that takes us out of the consulting room. As an analyst, I found it not only stimulating, but also integral to my relationship to psychoanalysis to extend its applications beyond the consulting room. Over the past 13 years, I've consulted to television production companies involved in making reality television shows. This has typically involved screening participants to ensure that they are psychologically fit to take part. And I've now assessed in excess of 300. So the thoughts I have are based on a fairly large sample. But during this time, I've developed a particular interest in makeover shows, for obvious reasons, that provided me with invaluable insights into the way individuals' dynamics interact with social processes in relation specifically to the body. I won't have a chance to go into this, but we can certainly pick it up in our discussion. But beyond this, it also stimulated thoughts about the quality of the gaze itself that is promoted by such programs, That is how we, the viewers, are invited to look at the participants in these shows. And this is what I want to say just a few words about. I think we live in scopophilic times in which voyeurism and vicarious living are the order of the day. Whether we are committed fans of reality TV or its arch critics, at some stage or other, we have all, at the very least, stumbled over someone's trauma as we flick through our TV channels. The voyeur, which is in all of us, always participates through the gaze. The gaze can never be innocent. We can never be innocent bystanders. By definition, if we see something, there is no looking back. This applies as much to us in our role as analysts as it does to us as citizens. Reality TV as a genre corrupts the social gaze as a form of looking after into a form of superegoish watching. Some of you may be familiar with the BBC programme What Not to Wear, which I think is a very good example of this and the kind of shaming of people made to feel that they shouldn't look a particular way. Looking can never be free from the snares of unconscious projection. The best we can strive for is to commit ourselves to an ongoing analytic process within ourselves, by which I mean that we remain humble in relation to the unconscious and our more or less partial ignorance of it, so that we can strive to undo the projections through which we rid ourselves of anxiety, not least anxiety about the fact of our unavoidable lack and dependency, and the incorporation through which we cover up this lack over and over again. We can only ever strive for partial success in these domains. But this is no excuse for abrogating social responsibility towards each other. We need to take responsibility for how we look at the other and the ethical necessity of renewing our commitment to this self-questioning project. The ethical moment requires us to be prepared to look again, but with a different lens. Psychoanalysis and the internal work it encourages us to do provides us with one such invaluable lens. And for this, we have much to thank Freud for. Thank you.